centering this music this morning is the Largo from the New World Symphony by Dvořák.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to First Parish in Lexington. My name is Elizabeth Yoss. I am a worship associate here. We are a Unitarian Universalist congregation guided by the doctrine of love. Whether you are joining us this morning here in the pews or joining us online, we hope that you will find many reasons to return. We hope that you'll find here questions that stretch you, people to befriend you, and liberal religious values that challenge you to join us in loving boldly and living justly and welcoming radically. We have a few announcements this morning. First, all visitors and newcomers at First Parish are invited to meet and have a conversation with Reverend Ann and with the Members and Friends Committee. It will be in the church parlor at 11:45. That is the end of the service, directly after the service, immediately following the worship service. And it's an opportunity for you to learn about the church mission, the activities, and to share your story of what brings you here to First Parish. Bring your questions about First Parish and about Unitarian Universalism with you. And the church parlor is right through those doors right there. Next, we have Tom Rich, who has an announcement.
No, I don't.
You don't? Am I announcing anything?
No,
I am not announcing anything at this moment. Instead, from the Finance Committee, I do have the request, the Capital Campaign draft plaque. This is a plaque that has the names of people who contributed to the Capital Campaign. There's a draft of that on the wall in Parish Hall. Please go in there today and check whether your name is on there. And if it should be, and you would like it to be, should I say, first of all, check that it's spelled correctly. And if it's not there, talk to David Beauvais, who is right there. He'd be more than happy to add you or make the changes that are necessary. Coming up next Sunday is a church luncheon, Sunday, April 7th, after the service. But you do need to sign up. It is the church's New Vision, Mission, and Congregation-Wide Covenant that we'll be talking about. And so we can also just enjoy each other's company over lunch. And please see Wednesday's weekly update in your email to register so you can best plan for food. Now, this is a good time to talk about the weekly update, which is a fantastic method to see news. You will notice in your order of service, there's also a fantastic way to get up to date on other church activities, which is the FP chat. These are electronic media. Please talk to the church administrator, call the phone or email, and then you'll get all this information. We have weekly information about all sorts of programming. We have the racial justice team doing a pizza movie night. We have our buildings and bridges team who are doing radical kindness. We have our climate action team that has information, even information about other events around town. This is really the sole way you can get communication. So that is all I have. Right now, you can take all of that and ponder that and talk to your neighbor next to you and introduce yourself.
Our call to worship this morning is by the Reverend David Bredeen. He writes, "Welcome to this place where certainty transforms to questions. This place that takes what is and imagines what can be. Welcome to this space where what was fixed begins to shift, where rigidity embraces unfolding as we join in the dance of transformation. Welcome to this moment of change where together we transfigure and transcend together. Our music this morning is the Gloria in Excelsis Deo from Haydn's Heiligmesse, sung by our sanctuary choir.
This morning we have Amy Jabinson, a member of our board, lighting our chalice. The reading is by Lee Kinvey, A True Story. This is a chalice for the living, the changing, the becoming. This chalice is for losing the script of your life, the chapters about who you are in other people's stories. This chalice is for the lost GPS that was supposed to show you how to get where they expected you to go. This chalice is for skipping the directions, coloring outside the lines, painting not by number, but by silence, by wild abandon, with a brush you made yourself from light deep inside. Startling, vivid, a new voice that already knows you. Finally, a true story. And now I invite you in body or spirit to join me in saying our affirmation of faith. Love is the doctrine of this church. The quest for truth is its sacrament.
This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another, to the end that all souls shall grow into harmony with God.
Our time for all ages this morning is a story about treasure, and I need your help. When I say the word treasure, often we think of ooh. So when I say treasure, could you say ooh? And when I say treasure of kings, could you say ah? So treasure, ooh. Treasure of kings, ah. You guys are awesome. Once upon a time in a village near Krakow, Poland, there lived a rabbi whose name was Yitzhak. Yitzhak was the son of a famous rabbi, Reb Yekel, whom all the people of his village had loved for his wisdom. When Reb Yekel died, the whole village mourned, and Rabbi Yitzhak made certain to follow in his father's footsteps. He was wise and fair, just as his father had been. And like his father, he also was generous. He never turned away anyone in need, and because so many people came to him for help, he had soon lost all of his worldly possessions. But Rabbi Yitzhak cared nothing for things. He wanted only to be a good man, and that he was. As time passed, though, he grew poorer and poorer, and he began to wish for just one thing. He wanted to build a synagogue for his people. One night, Rabbi Yitzhak dreamed that he was in the beautiful city of Prague, standing beside a bridge that led to the king's palace. Beneath that bridge, he saw a hole, and in that hole was a bag brimming with gold. Oh, how lovely it would be to have that bag of gold, the rabbi thought. And even in his dream, he laughed as he imagined digging up the treasure of kings. The next night, the rabbi fell asleep and once again dreamed the same dream. And there it was, the gold, vivid and glittering, a treasure vast enough to allow him to build a synagogue for his people. A treasure buried in the hole beneath a bridge that led to the king's palace in Prague. When the rabbi awoke the next morning, he smiled and then he said, "Ah, what a fine thing that gold would be." And that night he once more dreamed of that gold beneath the bridge near the palace in Prague. And when he awoke this time, he did not simply laugh, for now he understood that this was a prophecy. He was meant to find the treasure of kings. Quickly, he departed for Prague without a thought for the hardship of such a long journey. He walked for many days, and his old shoes were nearly worn through by the time he reached Prague. Before long, he found the bridge of his dreams. And just as he had seen in his dream, the bridge led to the palace. His heart pounded with hope. But there was one thing that was different. This bridge had no hole beneath it, and it was guarded day and night by dozens of uniformed guards. The rabbi could never dig a hole without being discovered, and so he did not dig. Instead, he walked back and forth across the bridge day after day. He returned each day, and as he walked, he gazed below, dreaming of the treasure of kings. One day, a guard spotted the rabbi gazing wistfully beneath the bridge. "I see you standing here each day," the guard said. "You seem to be waiting for something. Is there anything I can do to help you?" Rabbi Yitzhak solemnly shook his head. "It is kind of you to ask," he said to the guard. "I have walked here all the way from Krakow, for I dreamed that beneath this bridge there was a treasure of gold." The guard burst out laughing. "Oh, so that is why your shoes are worn through. But what a fool you are. I too have dreamed of gold. Once I dreamed that there was a treasure of kings beneath a stove in a village near Krakow. It was owned by a fellow named Yitzhak, son of a man named Yekel. Can you imagine if I had gone to Krakow and asked for such a man? everyone would have laughed at me. Rabbi Yitzhak only smiled when he heard of this man's dream. So you do not believe in the wisdom of dreams? He asked. I believe only what I see, the guard said. That which I can see, I know is real. Thank you, Rabbi Yitzhak said, and then he turned and he walked back home. When he reached his house after his journey, he dug a hole beneath his stove. And there, in plain sight, lay the treasure. Just as the guard had seen it, a treasure of dreams. I wonder, what kind of dreams do you have? Do you gain wisdom from these dreams? We have had many dreams for this congregation, and today we celebrate the treasure given from our own pockets, which will help us to bring to fruition a treasure of dreams. Thank you. I invite you now to join in our opening hymn, When We Are Gathered, which is number 359, if you want to use your hymnal.
Good morning, everyone. Today, the Committee on Leadership and Service would like us all to recognize three different groups who support First Parish and its mission in our broad community. They are Lex Rapp, the Youth Counseling Connection, and Voices on the Green. First Parish has been a longtime supporter of the Lexington Refugee Assistance Program, known as Lex Rapp. Lex Rapp's mission is to welcome refugees, help them settle into their new surroundings, and link them with needed resources. Lex Rapp currently provides long-term support to 25 families in Lexington and surrounding communities. Lex Rapp has also played an important role in helping the migrant families currently living in Lexington hotels. I would like to ask Tom Rich, board member at Lex Rapp, to stand up and be recognized, and also ask all who have generously volunteered or made financial contributions to support Lex Rapp to also stand up and be recognized. And as an additional request, I would ask all who have stood up to stay standing, and I would like to ask all of the additional volunteers who have helped this year with the Lexington sheltered families, please to stand as well. The Youth Counseling Connection is an independent nonprofit agency that provides accessible counseling and outreach services to Lexington youth and their families, right here in our church building where they are a tenant. The YCC mission is to improve the emotional wellness of youth in our community. Youth and families of all cultures, religions, genders, and sexual identities are welcomed. I would like to ask board member and founder, Connie Counts, current board co-chair, Ann Kadari, and volunteer communications manager, Audra Meyerberg, to please stand and be recognized for their invaluable service. The mission of Voices on the Green is to build community. To pursue that mission, Voices on the Green creates highly engaging and highly supportive events where diverse individuals are brought closer together through shared personal storytelling and music making. Through these events, Voices on the Green seeks to do three things. First, to strengthen and sustain First Parish's existing community. Second, to welcome and engage new friends and neighbors into the First Parish community. And third, to increase the participation and value of First Parish's role in the larger community. The following people bring these events to life here at First Parish, and I'd like to ask them to now stand and be recognized. David Rose, Reggie O'Hare Gibson, Amy Jameson, Sarah Mannix, Tom Wanderer, Deb Weiner Soul, Deborah Lapidus, Suzanne Adams, Andreas Padilla, Ruth Rose, Omar Kadari, and David Horton. And also, would any and all volunteers at these events please stand and be recognized? And lastly, would all persons who have told their stories and performed music now stand and be recognized? What a wonderful recognition of community building here at First Parish. And I do have a PSA. Voices on the Green, the next show is April 12th. And it's called Breaking the Rules, and tickets will be available in the social hour room after service. Thank you.
So, good morning, everyone. I get to tell you some great news. The first piece of good news is that the stewardship campaign is ending today. So we don't need to talk about money anymore. But more importantly, I am cautiously optimistic that we will reach our goal. An all-time record, our goal was $505,000, and I am reasonably confident that we will reach that. So on behalf of the stewardship team, I want to thank everyone who has made a financial pledge to the church. And more importantly, to those who haven't yet, but I am very confident that they will by midnight tonight, thank you for that. And we actually have one more good piece. We have one more piece of good news.
That's right. We're going to celebrate. Yeah, right? So we're going to celebrate the end of the drive and a successful drive next Saturday, 6 p.m. with a party. Fun for all ages. There's going to be dinner, beer, wine. And we ask that you all participate and join. I'll say that the Ministry of Fun has promised that this is going to be the funnest party ever. So there's an RSVP link in the weekly email. Please click on that and join us for the festivities.
And once again, thank you for your support.
Thank you.
Our First Parish.
Thank you to Tom Rich and to Dave and to Omar Kadari for their incredible work running this campaign. We could not do this without you. Thank you. One of the visions that we have for First Parish is to have a three-quarter time staff person to work with our youth and help our congregation to connect across generations. The search team has had an astonishing number of excellent applications, which I am so excited about. And we're still in the midst of that search. But I'm very encouraged by this, and your support of our campaign makes it possible for us to hire this person and to offer them a contract once we've decided on who that will be. So thank you so much for your generosity in making our staff team able to be fully staffed. So we're going to have a ritual of celebration. Some years we've had printed pledge cards, but this year we're trying something a little different. So bear with us in the spirit of transformation and shift. Whenever I travel, I like to find a fountain in the middle of the courtyard in the center of town. And as I look at it, I often see coins lying there in the center of the fountain. I wonder, what the wishes and the hopes were of the person who threw that money into the fountain. I wonder who collects that money. Is it a gift? Is it magic? Is it a treasure of dreams? So I'd like to invite you to join a new ritual as we finish our pledge campaign and celebrate how we are fueling the vision of First Parish. We are so grateful that you have all gifted First Parish with three equally important things: your time, your talents, and your treasure. Truly, we have a treasure of dreams right here in our own sacred house. So I ask you, as part of this campaign, whether you've donated time, talent, or treasure, whether you intend to respond to Tom's call to do that soon, whether you're trying to make sure that Larry Roop doesn't come and, no, that's a joke. But if you're willing, come forward, take one of the pennies that are here and drop it in that little water fountain that's right next to it. If you'd like, you can speak into the microphone one of your hopes or something that you hope for our church moving forward, or some reason why you've chosen to support us this year. And then take an energy bar home with you. Save it for one of those hangry moments when you really need something to help you feel stable. And remember us, that you fuel the church and the church fuels you. So please come forward, drop a penny in the fountain, and Rip will give us some beautiful music as we participate in this ritual together.
An intergenerational musical.
Yes, my wish is for diversity, more diversity.
World peace.
Reinvigoration.
Music. Friendship and community.
For the new work for the youth.
For the joy of our music.
Peace.
Fellowship.
Happy children.
Continuing the senior high mission trips and expanding them to include younger kids as well.
More visibility in the community.
Renovate the front of the sanctuary.
Spiritual growth.
Growth.
continued peace and happiness.
Joy.
Peace.
Place where kids love social hour as much as they love RE.
Growth.
Peace.
Continued spiritual growth.
More meditation.
So you won't be surprised to know it takes more than a penny for the church programs to continue. I have these words of offering written by John Saxon. This religious community exists by its mission as a fire exists by burning. But a fire cannot burn without fuel. And it is the time, the energy, the imagination, the vision, the creativity, the compassion, the love, and the financial support of the members and friends of this community that fuels our mission to nurture and sustain a welcoming, inclusive, and diverse liberal religious community that transforms lives and serves the world. Your support, the free and generous support of each and every member and friend of this community, is what fuels this community, its mission, and without your support, the flame of justice, community, and love cannot burn brightly to warm ourselves and be a beacon in a world threatened by division and fear. An offering for the work of First Parish will now be received. You may point your camera at the QR code in the order of service or whether you're online. And if you are here in the sanctuary, our ushers will come around and take your offering. Our offertory today is Weg der Liebe by Johannes Brahms, sung by Julia Jaffe and Yunona, Tabala.
Yeah.
Our reading this morning is by Lee Young Lee. And Lee Young Lee was born in Jakarta, Indonesia, and was raised in Pennsylvania. Though sometimes described as a supremely lyric poet, Lee's poems often use narrative and personal experience or memories to launch their investigations of the universal. Lee talked about his belief in the openness of all things in an interview with Tina Chang for the Academy of American Poets. He says, "If you rigorously dissect it, you realize that everything is a shape of the totality of causes. And what's another name for the totality of causes? The cosmos. So everything is a shape of cosmos, or God. It feels like something bigger than me that I can't possibly fathom, but am embedded in." So here is his poem. It's up on the screen, will be up on the screen. One heart. Look at the birds. Even flying is born out of nothing. The first sky is inside you, open at either end of the day. The work of wings was always freedom, fastening one heart to every falling thing. I'm going to read that one more time. Look at the birds. Even flying is born out of nothing. The first sky is inside you, open at either end of the day. The work of wings was always freedom, fastening one heart to every falling thing.
The first sky is inside you. What does that mean to you? The first sky is inside you. To me, it is more image than theory, an image of openness, of flight, of freedom. And in these oppressive days, I need that. I suspect you do as well. If we have a sense of openness inside of us, what more might be possible? When we begin to lose a sense of possibility, of openness, that is when the inner panic begins to tremble. With each news article about the brokenness of our world, the escalation towards famine in Gaza, the polarization of our politics, I feel my boundaries shrinking. I feel my worry begin to rise. I was particularly distressed by the law pending a signature from Alabama Governor Kay Ivey, which guts the presentation of educational programs on diversity, equity, and inclusion in the state of Alabama. This law would not only ban Alabama state funding for diversity, equity, and inclusion programs at public universities, but local boards of education and government agencies, but also limit the teaching of what they have called divisive concepts surrounding race, gender, and identity. Florida has a similar law on the books, and as the New York Times reported this week, the prohibitions are largely focused on the teaching of divisive concepts, which the bill defines in part as assigning fault, blame, or bias to any race, religion, gender, or nationality. Other examples of divisive concepts include teaching that a person is, quote, inherently responsible for actions committed in the past, or that a person should accept, acknowledge, affirm, or assent to a sense of guilt, complicity, or need to apologize based on their race, religion, gender, or background, unquote. Wow. This goes against pretty much everything that I've been preaching for the last 8 years. This will enshrine racism into Alabama law, a state with a long and sordid history of educational segregation and racism. How can we truly face the truth of our history if we protect ourselves from the chance of feeling badly about it? Why should we prioritize one person's right to feel good over the right of everyone to talk about the truth? How can we move towards equity and equality if we silence some voices so that others feel not responsible for the state of the world? I feel the deep-seated fear that we hold for the future of this planet. It is an existential angst, and sometimes I don't know where to turn. Does this happen to you as well? I'm thinking it might. It is in times like these, my friends, that we need to remember that one of our sacred values is the value of transformation, the possibility of transformation. And it is so important that it is in our draft of our new principles and purposes. As theologian Sherry Prudhomme has written, our religion can and will change by the discovery or unveiling of new truths and new ways of understanding all existence and the sacred. At its core, then, our theological heritage proclaims an abiding openness to change. We have long proclaimed that revelation is not sealed. This means that new truths are being revealed to us all the time. It means that religion will change, and that we will change as well. And this is good. It may be scary, but it's good. It means that when we address the wrongs of the past and make an honest attempt at reparation and repair, that we will become better people. Tracing our theological history, Dr. Prudhomme continues, from our early roots in Unitarian and Universalist Christianity, through the blossoming of humanism and ongoing dialogue with scientific developments, to the re-emergence of a sense of spirituality in creative interplay with humanism, process theology, liberation theologies, and religious naturalism, to a religious pluralism that embraces traditions and practices emerging from the organic multi-religiosity of Unitarian Universalists today. Unitarian Universalism has evolved in the context of a changing American and global society, and in response to new insights from an ever-widening circle of voices and perspectives. I so appreciate Dr. Prudhomme's theology to help us learn about our own history. This is our UU faith tradition, all of these multiple ways of understanding reality. This is who I believe we are as First Parish in Lexington. And transformation is an inherent part of who we are. It was such an amazing thing to be present with you all last weekend as the racial justice team offered such a carefully prepared and deeply theological worship experience, recognizing the 163 Black individuals who have been part of this congregation's history, some enslaved, some free. It was a powerful worship service, and if you are not there, ask someone who was, or watch it on our YouTube channel. Be sure to go to the front entrance of our church and spend time with the art installation, which is now there, which we created together, containing sashes with all of the precious names of these people embroidered on cloth. Is this a divisive concept? Perhaps. Does it fill us with guilt, complicity, and a need to apologize? It does, yes. But is that a bad thing? Because when we do this within the theological framework of our faith and within the safe space of this covenantal community. We know that we are all capable of doing bad things and being part of a flawed system. We know that the world we live in has long given more possibilities to white people, and that white folks have claimed this for themselves as their birthright. But we are not here to collapse in guilt. We are here to keep our eyes open, to recognize the truth of our past, and boldly to make new choices for the future. This can happen here because we have a theology of transformation. We know that none of us are perfect as we are. We accept that we all must change to make this world more fair. And together we work for our own transformation so that together we can transform the world. That's why the value of transformation is lifted up as one of the seven values in our new Article 2. This is why the path of transformation opens us to a new way for us all to move forward. Do you know why the service last week was so well received? Because you, my friends, have been working so hard over the past few years. We started with a program called Beloved Conversations. And there were only six of us that took part of that as we joined with the Concord UU Church. But it was enough to get the momentum started, wasn't it? Those of you who are here, I see you. I see you smiling. Yeah, we were there. And then we joined with the Church of Our Redeemer, the Episcopal Church just down the street, and together we wrote a curriculum on dismantling racism. We have witnessed this curriculum moving throughout Lexington, encouraging hundreds of people in this town to address the systemic racism in which we live and to make steps towards change. You voted to hang a Black Lives Matter banner on the front of our church. The wind blew it to pieces, but it will be replaced. A couple of years ago, we started studying the eighth principle, and you voted to adopt this language and add it to our seventh principles. Our eighth principle implementation team took this as a charge and have been working steadily since, helping us to write a new covenant and new bylaws which are more inclusive. And then in just a couple of weeks, on April 7th, you are invited to a luncheon so that you will be prepared to make an educated vote on whether or not you want to adopt this new mission, vision, and covenant. It's filled with language about the way we want to be in the world. The new draft of the vision reads like this. The vision of First Parish is to be a beacon of hope, love, and joy on the Lexington Green. A diverse, intergenerational, beloved community where we find the support, courage, and inspiration to act within, among, and beyond our congregation with compassion, equity, and justice. All of these steps have put us on the path of transformation. If we had not been doing this for so many years, if we had not been preparing the soil for a rich harvest, we would not have been able to participate with such open hearts in the powerful act last week of recognizing our church's history of enslavement in the history of Lexington. I am so proud of you, my friends. I am so proud. It has been a long journey, a slow and steady journey, which has pulled you all gradually into a new, more beloved, more open-hearted space as a congregation. It had been my deepest wish since I arrived here in 2016 that we would make this journey together, and we are. We're not finished yet, but we are on the path, and that feels so encouraging to me. I hope it does to you as well. I am excited also about all the work that all of our social justice teams are doing. Our Preserving Democracy presented a powerful service a few weeks ago. Our Climate Action Team will help us recognize the work we need to do at our upcoming Earth Day service these lay-led services are such an important part of who we are as a congregation. So I close today with the inspiration for the title of the sermon today. Jan Phillips writes of the image of recognizing the acorn in the oak of our being. I just love that image. We want to grow into that tall, mighty oak of strength and beauty, but most of the time we don't know how to start. So what would happen if we each took time to find within ourselves a simple, tiny acorn? Small enough to slip into your pocket, delicious enough to feed squirrels or pound into flour. If planted in rich soil and given air and sunlight and water, that inner acorn has the possibility to sprout, to grow, to slowly ascend the heights of the forest. What does that acorn look like to you? Can you picture it? Can you vision it growing inside you, helping you to grow into that strong oak tree of your dreams? Can you see your branches spreading wide enough to shelter the birds of the air? Can you see yourself fecund enough to provide acorns for all the animals in the forest? As Jan Phillips said, we are attendants at the wake of the old way, and each of us, through our actions, our thoughts, our work, our relationships, is midwifing a new world into existence. This is our destiny, our meaning, our purpose, and when we come to our days with this awareness, when we fully wake up to this tremendous privilege, when we sense the acorn in the oak of our being, we will have energy to move mountains and shift tides. It is an illusion that we are powerless. It is an illusion that someone else is responsible. It is an illusion that we cannot transcend these dualities and differences that make a mockery of our democracy. We are the people, and this is our world. My friends, we are on this journey together, the journey of transformation. The first sky is inside you. The work of wings was always freedom, fastening one heart to every falling thing. Thank you for supporting this pathway with your presence, with your prayers, with your service, with your incredible generosity. I love you all, and I am so, so grateful for each and every one of you. Amen. Our anthem is Distant Land by John Rutter.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, choir. Our flowers today were given by the Fenn family in honor of their grandparents and their father, Dan Fenn, who would have turned 101 on March 27th. We still miss you, Dan. I wanted to let you know that our beloved member, Elaine Toronto, is in hospice care at her home. It has been a long struggle for her, as many of you know, and we hold her in our hearts, and her husband, Carmen. I'm also wanting to pray for the recent, for our member, Ed Sheldon, who passed away recently. His family will be gathering at Carlton Willard on April 6th at 11 o'clock. So please join with me in prayer. Creative Spirit, source of love and life, we give thanks for each person present today, for their life, for their loves, for their connections to each other. Thank you for the incredible generosity of these gathered people whose gifts will support our journey to becoming a beacon of hope, love, and joy on the Lexington Green. You have set us on the path towards transformation, and you have supported us at every turn. We are grateful, and we are challenged to continue to grow. Our work is not complete. There is so much suffering in this world, especially in the continued strife in Ukraine and the approaching famine in Gaza. Our hearts are breaking with each story of those who are unsheltered, who cannot find food or clean water, and who suffer the constant threat of bombs. We especially hold all who have been affected by the mass shooting in Moscow. We ask for the spirit of healing to flow through that community. Help us all, gracious one, to find a way to bring peace to this constant warfare. Offer aid to the hungry, and help those who see themselves as enemies to be open to a new sense of interdependence and connection. Give us courage to live our values out loud, to work for a world in which all people, especially those who are marginalized, can find justice and equity. With gratitude for our many blessings of love and generosity, and with deep and abiding love for this sacred community, we say, Amen. Amen. My friends, I invite you to join us in singing our closing hymn, which is Building a New Way. Allow yourself to really get your groove on with this piece, because it's really fun to sing.
Thank you.
My friends, hold fast to our vision of what can be. Fuel that vision and be fueled by it. May we see the hope in our history and find the courage and the voice to work for that constant rebirth of freedom and justice. Amen. Please be seated for our postlude, which is the fugue in C minor by Johann Sebastian Bach.